important topic, especially from the clinical point of view, and even the nowadays the number of cases of this myocardial infarction, the MI, heart attacks are increasing because of the modern lifestyle. So let's look into what is the cause for this myocardial infarction. So what is the cause for myocardial infarction? Heart attacks, what is the cause?
Embolism.
Atherotic clot or clot in the coronary vessels leading to ischemia of the myocardium, right? So as the myocardial cells are not able to regenerate like your the nervous tissue cells, so the complication. Okay, so as even the myocardial cells are also not able to regenerate just like the nervous tissue cells. So this becomes very important to study into what are the vessels, the coronary vessels will supply the heart, okay? So that you can go for the procedures like angioplasty or bypass surgeries so that you can prevent the further infarctions at all. So you, from an anatomical point of view, it must be very important to look into what are the vessels which are supplying the heart, what is their course, okay, so that you can manipulate them surgically. Clear? Yeah. So any circulation means is having an arterial blood supply and venous drainage, right? So along with that, even we have few points about the lymphatic drainage also. So arterial supply and venous drainage. So the word coronary means what?
Coronary means
the crown, you know, the crown worn by a king. So as these vessels surround the heart like a crown over the heart, so these vessels are called as the coronary vessels. So coronary arteries and the veins also. So arterial supply, as I said, the cardiac muscle is supplied by the coronary arteries, which are two in number. How many? Two in number. What are they? The right and left coronary arteries. The right and left coronary arteries. And both these vessels, they arise from the aorta itself, the ascending aorta, at the base of the ascending aorta, where you have the cusps, you know. Aorta is guarded by the valves, right? So, at the site of attachment of these valves to the aortic wall, okay, so it forms a dilation. The base of the aorta forms a dilation. They are called as the sinuses. They are called as sinuses. We have three cusps, so three sinuses. Anterior aortic sinus, left posterior and right posterior aortic sinuses. What are these sinuses? What are these sinuses? Is the dilation. The dilation of the base of the aorta where you have the attachment of the cusps. Cusps of the walls guarding the aortic opening. Am I clear? Clear? Okay, they are the called as the aortic sinuses. How many are there? So three cusps, so three sinuses. Anterior aortic sinus, okay, and the left posterior and then right posterior. Clear? Three sinuses are there. So from these sinuses you have the beginning of or the origin of these coronary artery. That is the right coronary artery and then the left coronary artery. So let's look into from where they arise and how they run, what are their branches. So you can see that in the picture very clearly, you can see the base of the heart showing these dilations. Clear? This is the dilation, right? One more will be around the posterior side, okay? That is the right posterior. So those are the aortic sinuses. This is what is the anterior aortic sinus. This is the left posterior aortic sinus, okay? So from this you have the origin of this coronary artery. This is the right coronary artery. This is the left coronary artery. Clear? So the right coronary artery. So it is smaller than the left coronary artery compared to its size. The right coronary artery is smaller than the left coronary artery. As I said, it arises from the anterior coronary sinus, or you can say the aortic sinus. Okay, anterior aortic sinus. So where is the origin of right coronary artery? Anterior aortic sinus. Okay. Yeah. So course. You can see it here, the course of the vessel. So soon after its origin from the anterior aortic sinus, it runs towards the right border. Okay, it runs towards the right border and then winds around the inferior border. Winds around the inferior border and goes posterior. Clear? So where does it run? It runs on the right anterior what? What is the sinus called as? The sulcus. Anterior coronary sulcus. Right anterior coronary sulcus. They are called as coronary sulcus because of the course of the coronary arteries in the sulcus. So are also called as atrioventricular sulcus. You have anterior atrioventricular or the coronary sulcus, and then similarly on the posterior side, posterior atrioventricular sulcus. So these atrioventricular sulcus are called as coronary sulcus because the coronary arteries are situated in that sulcus. Clear? Okay. So this right coronary artery begins from the anterior aortic sinus, runs downwards in the right anterior coronary sulcus towards the inferior border, where it winds out and then goes posteriorly. So that is right posterior coronary sulcus, and anastomoses with the left coronary artery at the crux of the heart. What is that? At the crux of the heart. What is the crux of the heart?
The
posterior coronary sulcus, the joining of the posterior interventricular sulcus and the posterior coronary sulcus. Did you forget the first lecture what I told you? The crux, I repeated it many times. Okay, so have the posterior coronary sulcus between atria and then ventricle. You have interventricular sulcus like this. Okay, the joining of the interventricular sulcus and posterior coronary sulcus is called as the crux, where you have the anastomosis of right as well as left coronary arteries. Okay, the terminal branches, the anastomosis. So that is the course of the right coronary artery. I repeat, it begins from the anterior aortic sinus, runs downwards towards the inferior border or the lower border in the right anterior coronary sulcus, winds around the inferior border, runs posteriorly in the posterior right posterior coronary sulcus, and anastomoses with the left coronary artery at the crux of the heart. Here, this is the course about the right coronary artery. So now let's look into what are its branches. So what are the branches? So you have the bigger branches called as the marginal and post anterior, that is posterior interventricular branch. These are the two bigger branches. What is that? Marginal artery. Which marginal artery? Right marginal artery and posterior interventricular artery. These are the two big branches. Okay. And smaller branches are right atrial, infundibular, nodal and terminal branches. So what do you mean by infundibular? What is the infundibulum of the heart?
The outflow.
Of what?
Of the
right ventricle. The outflow part of the right ventricle, where you have the beginning of the pulmonary artery, pulmonary trunk. That is, we call it as the infundibular artery. The branch which supplies the infundibular area is called as the infundibular artery. So what are the two big branches? Right marginal and posterior interventricular. Okay, smaller branches are the right atrial branches, infundibular branches and nodal branches. What is that? Nodal. So what do you mean by nodal? What do you mean by nodal?
Nodes.
You have the conducting system of the heart. Conducting system of the heart consists of two nodes, SA node and AV node. Between them we have the bundles of fibers. Okay. So this SA node and AV node, in 60% of the cases it is supplied by the right coronary artery. So conducting system of the artery, in majority of the cases it is supplied by the right coronary artery. Am I clear? Okay, and then terminal branches. As I said, at the crux, it anastomoses with the left coronary artery. So let's look into these branches. Okay, this is one more picture showing you So this is the right coronary artery, right? Okay, it's beginning from the anterior aortic sinus. So this is what is the SA nodal artery, which winds around the aorta and runs between the pulmonary trunk and the aorta and then supplies the SA node. Where is the SA node? It is in the right atria, right atria wall. Okay, so it runs posteriorly and then supplies the SA node. And then you have the atrial branches, which supplies the right atrium. And then these are the infundibular branches. See there? These are the infundibular branches which supplies the infundibulum of the heart. And then these are the marginal branches which runs along the lower border and then supplies the right ventricle. Right? Ventricle. And posteriorly you have the posterior interventricular artery. Yes? Any confusion there? So, okay, so as I said, these branches, so what is their area of distribution? So, atrial branches, they supply right atrium. So, then even it supplies, majority of the right ventricle is supplied by the right marginal artery, infundibular artery. What they supply? They supply the right ventricle, right? Majority of the right ventricle and small part of the left ventricle, especially towards the septum, interventricular septum. Okay. The posterior inferior part of this, so this is the, if you consider this as septum, this is right ventricle and left ventricle. Okay. You have this, the anterior interventricular group, posterior interventricular group. So posterior inferior part of septum, the lower part of the posterior part of the septum is supplied by posterior interventricular artery, because there is one more artery which runs on the anterior interventricular sulcus. That will be supplying the anterior part of the septum. Did you follow? Not on the heart. Can I go just go to the museum and bring the heart?
Yes.
Okay. So wait for 2 minutes. Just I will come back. Because
it's the aorta. Okay. So you can see the right coronary artery running downwards in the right anterior coronary sulcus, winding around the lower border. And then going posteriorly, okay, posterior, right posterior coronary sulcus, and then running down as this is the posterior interventricular artery. See, this is the posterior interventricular groove. This is the posterior interventricular artery. So now what I mean to say is, here the atrial branches are not shown, okay. So they will be running on the anterior side of the right atrium and then supply the right atrium, anteriorly as well as posteriorly, supplying the right atrium. And you can see this here, these are the infundibular branches. This is the infundibulum, right? This is the outflow part. These are the infundibular branches. And you can see this, these are the marginal branches which are running along the lower border. This is the lower border or inferior border, right? Supplying the whole of the right ventricle. Clear? And this is what is the posterior interventricular artery, where you have the septum inside. Can you see this? This is the interventricular septum. Am I right? So what I mean said is the posterior inferior part. This is a posterior. Okay? And then inferior. Posterior and inferior. The heart is like this. This is what is the diaphragmatic surface or the inferior surface, right? So this is the septum. This is the anterior side and this is the posterior side. The posterior inferior part of the interventricular septum is supplied by this posterior interventricular artery. Clear? So what are the branches? Atrial branches, both anteriorly and posteriorly, supplying the right atrium, and then the infundibular branches supplying the anterior outflow part of the right ventricle, the marginal branches supplying again the right ventricle, and the posterior interventricular branch supplying much of the posterior inferior part of your, or 2/3 of the interventricular septum is supplied by this posterior interventricular artery. Clear? Okay. Okay. So you followed these things, or I mean, you mean? Okay. So I said the right coronary artery gives three sets of branches. This is the one is the right atrial branches supplying the right atrium, both anteriorly and posteriorly, and have the infundibular branches which supply the infundibular area of the right ventricle, and you have the marginal branches which are running along the lower border, so supplying the adjacent surface, both anterior and posterior surface of the right ventricle, and you have the posterior interventricular artery supplying the two-thirds or posterior inferior two-thirds of the interventricular septum, and one branch which is called as the nodal branch, that is the supplying the SA node as well as the AV node. So it is given off just after the beginning. You can say the first branch from the right coronary is nodal artery, which runs between the aorta and then you have the atrium, or you can have the superior vena cava there. So it runs between them and then supplies the conducting system. Am I clear? So this is the story about the right coronary artery, right coronary artery. So what is the area of distribution? Can you repeat it again? Area of distribution, right coronary artery supplies what? Right atrium, right ventricle, posterior two-thirds of the interventricular septum, then the conducting system of the heart, very important. These are all supplied by right coronary artery, right coronary artery. Is that clear?
Yes.
So any block in this, any of these branches will give rise to the ischemia or infarction of the concerned area. For example, if there is blockage of the posterior interventricular artery, so then what happens? There is ischemia or infarction of the interventricular septum. Clear? So that is the, and even these names are different. For example, I said the posterior interventricular artery, I said it is even called as PDA, posterior descending artery. What is that? PDA. So clinically they are given some different names also. Okay, right marginal artery, RMA, they say RMA. Okay, the posterior descending artery are also called as posterior interventricular artery, and similarly AD, anterior descending artery, that is anterior interventricular artery. I will come to that. Okay, that is the left ventricle, left coronary artery. So now coming to the left coronary artery, left coronary artery. So left coronary artery arises from the left posterior aortic sinus. What is that? Left posterior aortic sinus. What is the origin of left coronary artery? Left posterior aortic sinus. As I already told you in the first lecture, the left part of the anterior coronary sulcus is not clear because of the overriding of these vessels. Right? So immediately after its origin, it runs posterior to your pulmonary trunk. So from here, posteriorly, okay, and runs in the left anterior coronary sulcus, which is not clear on the anterior side. Left anterior coronary sulcus, it runs. Okay, so soon after its origin from the left anterior aortic sinus, as it is running in the left anterior coronary sulcus, it gives a bigger branch which runs along the anterior interventricular groove, that is called as anterior interventricular artery. What is that? Anterior interventricular artery, or also called as anterior descending artery. This is this. Okay, anterior descending artery. And continuation of the left coronary artery is called as circumflex artery. What is that called as? Circumflex. See here, the artery begins from there. Okay, and gives from here the anterior descending. Okay, and now the continuation, the further continuation of the left coronary is called as circumflex artery. What is circumflex artery? Continuation of the same left coronary artery after it gives off anterior descending. Clear? The rest is called as the circumflex, because it winds round the left surface. Winds round the left surface and then goes posteriorly. Where? Posterior, left posterior coronary sulcus. Left posterior coronary sulcus. See here. So here. See that? Left coronary sulcus. So this is what is the circumflex branch. Okay? So here it gives many branches which are called as the left marginal branches, or we call them as the diagonal branches. What they are called as? The diagonal branches. The diagonal branches, anterior descending artery, okay, left circumflex, the left diagonal or the marginal branches, these are all branches, okay. Whereas the terminal part anastomoses with the right coronary artery at the crux. Right coronary artery at the crux. Okay? Clear? So the area of territory is the left atrium, the left ventricle, okay, much of the left ventricle, and rest of the septum, interventricular septum. Clear? Is that clear? This is the left coronary artery. Left coronary artery.
same as I said, runs forward on the left, emerges between the pulmonary trunk and the left auricle. As I told you, here the anterior interventricular branch is given and rest is continues as the circumflex artery. And after giving the off the anterior interventricular branch, it turns into the left coronary sulcus. Okay, and then continuation is called as circumflex, where it gives left marginal branches and then the diagonal branches. Okay, rest is continuous with the posterior, the left posterior coronary sulcus, and anastomosis with the right coronary artery at the crux. So, as I said, the bigger branch is the anterior interventricular, and even we can consider here the diagonal and even the left marginal branches also. The diagonal line. Left marginal branches also. The smaller branches include the left atrial branches, okay, and even the pulmonary branches supplying. These vessels even supply part of these, the great vessels also. So you can see there the branches of the left coronary artery. Just look into the labeling carefully, okay. See there? Did you follow? So there it is mentioned, that is the marginal branches, the diagonal branches, the anterior descending artery, okay. So they are all the branches from the left coronary. So concentrate on the diagrams, okay, where the labeling is done about the branches, okay. So as I told you, the different names like PDA. What do you mean by PDA? Posterior descending artery. What do you mean by ADA? Anterior descending. The diagonal branches, okay. These are the diagonal branches which supplies much of your the left ventricle and even left marginal. Okay, they all will supply the majority of your the left ventricle. So most of the left ventricle is supplied by left coronary artery. Okay. So that's the story about the right coronary artery and even the left coronary artery branches. So areas of distribution, the right left atrium. Mainly the left ventricle, okay, and then as I was talking to you, except the area about the posterior interventricular artery, which is supplied by the right coronary artery, a small part of the right ventricle adjoining the anterior interventricular groove and anterior part of the interventricular septum. Okay, that is the area of territory of the left coronary artery. Left coronary artery. Did you follow the area of territory? So now. Collateral circulation. What do you mean by collateral circulation? So how is the collateral circulation is possible? Because of the anastomosis, right? So, for example, one artery is coming to this area, okay? Okay, if there is any block in this artery, say as this artery is anastomosing with some other artery, okay? Blood from that artery will flow through this artery and then supply this area. That is what is called as collateral circulation. Collateral circulation. Yeah, the collateral circulation, for example, here is one artery which goes to this area, okay, which goes to this area. Think that there is a block here and any branch from this will have anastomosis with one more vessel coming, okay, and then if there is a block here, then blood will not be flowing from here to the downside, okay. So as there is anastomosis from other vessel, the blood will move to this vessel and this will supply the area. Like that, the bypass route you can say, okay. So that is what is called as the collateral circulation. So that is very important. If there is any the block in the vessel, the other route or what we call as the bypass route will they enlarge and then supply the area, keeping the area living by not causing your infarction. So the cardiac anastomosis, the two coronary arteries anastomose in the myocardium. So here you have to understand one point, these coronary vessels, they behave like end arteries. What do you mean by an end artery? They behave like end arteries functionally, but anatomically there is lot of anastomosis between the coronary vessels. Did you follow? Anatomically, there is lot of anastomosis between the coronary vessels, but functionally they behave like end artery. What do you mean by that? End arteries. End arteries means what? There is no collateral circulation. If there is any block, then that part of the heart is dead. that we call it as the end arteries because there is no anastomosis. But anatomically, as you see, there is anastomosis. Functional anastomosis and then anatomical anastomosis. Did you understand that point? So if you consider there is anastomosis, okay, between the two vessels. So what is this anastomosis? Purpose of this anastomosis is if there is any block here, this vessel will supply that area. Okay, there is anastomosis to see, but functionally, when it comes, for example, when there is any shock comes to the person, okay, suddenly his heartbeat increases. When the heartbeat increases, then what happens? The heart needs more blood. The heart needs more blood, and the coronary vessel which is supplying that area, what happens? It is already half blocked, okay? So already the blood going to that part of the heart is reduced, and when the workload on the heart increases, it needs more blood, more oxygen. So this blocked vessel is not able to supply that much blood to that part of the heart, okay? So then that goes for ischemia, infarction, then you will have heart attack. So what I mean to say now is, even though this vessel, there is anastomosis, this vessel could have supplied this part of the heart. The other vessel could have supplied this part of the heart, but it is not supplying. That means, actually there is no blood flow from the anastomotic channel to the area, functionally. Okay? But anatomically there is connection, but that is of no help when it is necessary. Okay? That is called as functional behavior, like functionally alike. That means like what? This anastomosis is of no use. No use. Even though there is anastomosis, it is of no use. Because it is not supplying the blood to the part of the heart. That means functionally this artery behaves like end arteries. But anatomically there is anastomosis. Did you follow? So how we can make them channelize? That is how we can make these end arteries behaving like end arteries, can we make them functionally the anastomotic channel? That's how they ask you to do regular exercises. Why they ask you to do regular exercises? What is the importance of exercises on the heart? Yeah, it increases slowly, work day by day, you are increasing the heart rate. Okay? The heart needs more blood, even though there is any blocks in the coronary vessels. So then these anastomotic channels, they become functionally active day by day. So as you do exercises, you are activating these anastomotic channels. So that's why usually the physicians ask you to do regular exercises. Then you will be activating these anastomotic channels. If you activate these anastomotic channels, even though there is any block in the block in the vessel, that is compensated by activating this anastomotic channel. That is the importance of exercise on the heart by this coronary vessels. Clear?
Yes, sir. Another practice, but another way is exercises.
What is the other way? How do you increase the workload on the heart?
Anxiety.
Anxiety will be staying for how many? Maybe 1 minute or 2 minutes. So, anyhow, you should increase the workload on the heart. It is how is the chance of increasing the workload on the heart? It is by the regular exercises, right? So that is the importance of this coronary anastomosis. Okay. So as I said, the coronary anastomosis is the coronary vessels to behave like end arteries functionally, even though there is anastomosis anatomically. Clear? Keep this point in mind. And even as the age advances, the younger peoples, that's why they say, no, if a younger people, maybe about 35 years of age person, he suffers from heart attack, then his prognosis is poor. His prognosis, future life is poor compared to a 55 or 60 years old person having the heart attack, and his prognosis will be better. Why? Because as the age advances, the workload on the heart continuously will be increasing. So there will be more active anastomotic channels as the age advances. Okay? But younger persons, they have a lesser active anastomotic channels. That's why the prognosis, the future prognosis will be poor in case of an adult suffering from myocardial infarction compared to a older person suffering from myocardial infarction, because of these active anastomotic channels. So now one more very important point here. We call it as the coronary dominance. What do you mean by dominance? He can be dominant on you because he is more powerful and like that. Okay. So dominance means the majority of the area supplied by one artery. How will you determine the dominance? Whether right coronary artery is dominant or left coronary artery is dominant. How will you determine? Mainly by the posterior descending artery. That is PDA. Okay. Maybe in the next slide it is there. So what is PDA? The posterior descending artery. Yeah? Okay. So listen to me. Okay. So posterior descending artery or the posterior interventricular artery, very important. So this determines the whether right coronary or left coronary dominance. If the posterior interventricular artery is a branch from right coronary artery, then it is right coronary artery dominant people or public or person. Okay. If the posterior interventricular artery is coming from left coronary artery, then we call him as left coronary dominance. So how do you determine the dominance, coronary dominance?
By
the posterior descending artery or the posterior interventricular artery. If it is coming from right coronary artery, that is much of the people, that is around 60% cases, the posterior interventricular is coming from the right coronary artery. So majority of the people are right coronary dominance. Right coronary dominance. If it is coming from left coronary, then we call it as left coronary dominance. So the persons with left coronary dominance, we call very unlucky persons, we can call them. Because as the much of the left ventricle, that is the main part of the heart which pumps blood to all parts of the body, right? So as this posterior interventricular, if it is coming from the left coronary artery, so the majority of the heart will be dominated by left coronary. So if there is any block in this left coronary, will give rise to more disastrous effect compared to the right coronary dominance. Okay, so that's why we call them as very unlucky people. Sometimes what happens, this posterior interventricular will be both from right and left, then we call them as balanced and they are very lucky people, you can say. Okay, so the posterior interventricular, if it is coming from both right and left, so they are the balanced type, whereas majority of the public it is the right coronary dominance because the posterior interventricular is arising from the right coronary artery. Yes.
So, in that case, there's no dominance?
No dominance. That's why I said balanced. So, that is the points about the coronary artery dominance. So, which vessel determines the dominance?
Posterior
interventricular artery or the posterior descending artery. So even about this functional point of this anastomosis, the anastomosis even exists, that is you can say these, they run below the epicardium, okay, the epicardial, and then these coronary vessels, they run above the epicardium, that is the main great vessels, and then as the smaller branches, they pierce the myocardium, okay, when they pierce the myocardium, so when the myocardium is contracting, so these vessels are affected by this myocardial contraction, and even so the down part, the interior part, so these are all running in the epicardium. Okay, so when these branches, they enter the myocardium, so myocardium will be always contracting, right, pumping. So then the blood supply to the interior part of the inner side of the, that is this endocardial, subendocardial part of the heart, suffers little lesser blood, so that is compensated by the direct transfusion of the nutrients and even the oxygen from the blood within the ventricles. Okay, so always the heart contains blood, so from this only there is nutrition to the vessels directly, not even from your the coronary vessels. Okay, so now about the venous drainage of the heart. So that is about the right coronary artery and then left coronary artery. So how the venous blood is drained from the heart. So you have the important vein which drains the heart is the coronary sinus. What is that? Coronary sinus.
So the venous draining of the heart by three means. So one by the coronary sinus, the anterior cardiac veins, and then the vena cardis minimi. So what is this vena cardis minimi? These are the small veins which are present around the heart, which directly open into the chambers of the heart. You might have studied in the interior of the right atrium. There is a feature called as vena cardis minimi. Many multiple openings within the right atrium. That means they will be draining directly blood, the venous blood, into the chambers of the heart. Okay, that is vena cardis minimi. And then one more is anterior cardiac vein, and the other is coronary sinus. Let's look into how they run, what is their course and all. Okay. So as I said, the coronary sinus, it is the largest vein of the heart. Where it is situated? The left posterior coronary sulcus. Left posterior coronary sulcus. So this is the heart anatomical position. Okay, the posterior sinus, the left posterior, left side. This is the right side. Okay, so this is what is the coronary sinus. What is this? Coronary sinus. This is the big vein of the heart. Okay, which drains much of the blood from the heart and drains into the right atrium. What is that vein? The coronary sinus. This is what is the coronary sinus. How is the coronary sinus formed? It is formed by the joining of these three veins, you can say. What is that? Great cardiac vein, middle cardiac vein, and small cardiac vein. So where are these veins present? It enters the left end of the coronary sinus. So that is, what is this? So this is the coronary sinus. Okay, so now this is the great cardiac vein. See this? This is what is the great cardiac vein. Great cardiac vein, and the vein which runs along with the posterior interventricular is the middle cardiac vein. What is this? The vein which runs along the posterior interventricular artery. See this? That vein is called as the middle cardiac vein. Great cardiac vein, middle cardiac vein. Okay. And even you have the small cardiac vein. It accompanies the right coronary arteries. It's not much clear in this model. Okay, anyhow, it will be shown in your, lab today's evening, or maybe tomorrow you have from the real specimens, plastinated hearts, okay? So what are the veins? The coronary sinus, very importantly, and then how is it formed? It is formed by the union of the great cardiac vein, the middle cardiac vein. You remember about middle cardiac vein, which runs along the posterior interventricular artery and then joins the coronary sinus. Okay, and then you have the small cardiac vein, and then posterior vein of the left ventricle, oblique vein of the left ventricle. So they all will be joining, because those veins are not shown in this model much. Okay, so they will all be joining the coronary. What are the tributaries of the coronary sinus? Great cardiac vein, small cardiac vein, middle cardiac vein, and then oblique vein of the left atrium. Oblique vein of the left atrium, which is important from the developmental point of view. Okay, so as it is the remnants of your left cardinal vein. So these are all the veins which drain the blood into the coronary sinus. What is the other vein which drains? There is no anterior cardiac vein here. So which drains directly blood into the right atrium. Okay, that is a separate vein which drains blood into the right atrium. Okay, so that's why I said three veins will be draining venous blood of the heart into the chambers. What is that? Anterior cardiac vein, coronary sinus, which is formed by the union of the great, small, the middle cardiac vein along with the oblique vein of the left atrium and even the posterior vein of left ventricle. Okay, and the other system of veins is the vena cardis minimi, which are smaller veins which are directly opening into different chambers of the heart. Clear? Anterior cardiac vein. Now the lymphatics of the heart, so mainly it forms like two coronary arteries. It forms two trunks which drain into your tracheobronchial lymph nodes and then bring your cephalic lymph nodes. That is the lymphatic drainage of the heart. Okay, what are the two lymph nodes where it drains lymph from the heart? Brachiocephalic and then tracheobronchial lymph nodes. And now, coming to the last part, so that is the peculiarities of coronary circulation. So what are the peculiarities about this coronary circulation compared to other part of the body where there is? So here, very importantly, the blood flows in all the parts of the body, the arteries. When do they receive the blood? During the systole. Am I right? During the systole, the all the arteries in the vessels, blood vessels in the body, the arteries, they receive blood during ventricular systole. Whereas in the coronary vessels, they receive during diastole. They receive during diastole. What happens? Did you understand that point? So if you consider this as the aorta, this as aorta, this is ventricle. So here are the origin of coronary vessels. Okay, right and left. Okay. So now what happens? Ventricle contracts. Ventricle contracts. The blood is pushed fast with the pressure into the aorta and then flows to all parts of the body. With that pressure, the coronary arteries will not be receiving blood. Clear? So what happens during diastole? During diastole, what happens? There is less pressure. So what happens? Whatever the blood is there in the aorta, it falls down. It falls back. It falls down. And you have the cusps preventing the backflow of blood into the ventricle. So now these sinuses, there is dilation. Okay. Now that sinuses, they will be filled with blood as the blood falls down. So now that blood will move to the coronary vessels. So that shows the coronary vessels, the coronary arteries receive blood during diastole, not during systole. Clear? So that is the only arteries in the body which receive blood during diastole. Okay. And what are the other important peculiar points? They, as I said, functionally they are end arteries but not anatomical. Clear? So then, high capillary density. Have much smaller capillaries, more of capillaries compared to other capillary networks in the body. Okay? And then, high oxygen extraction, because the heart needs more oxygen compared to other parts. So regulation is mainly by the metabolites. The regulation of the coronary circulation is by the metabolites, and there is anatomical anastomosis, but functionally they behave like end arteries. Okay? And the coronary vessels are susceptible to degeneration and atherosclerosis compared to other vessels. Other vessels in the body, the coronary vessels are more sensitive to this atherosclerosis. It is more common in coronary vessels compared to other vessels. So there is evident regional distribution. Subventricular, as I said, myocardial in the left ventricle receives less blood due to more myocardial compression. As I said, the vessels are passing through the myocardium. So when there is myocardium is contracting, it receives lesser blood. So that is compensated by during diastole, it is supplied much, and even by the blood present within the chambers of the heart, which will be supplying the subendocardial part of the heart. Okay, so direct perfusion. So now coronary artery disease. So very important, there is the ischemic heart disease. Okay, ischemic heart disease or coronary artery disease. So what is angina? What is angina? Angina is ischemia, not infarction. Try to differentiate between ischemia and infarction. Infarction is almost irreversible. Already the process of degeneration has started. Ischemia is a small moment of time there is lack of blood supply that causes building up of some of the metabolites which will give rise to the pain. And when you take rest, it is relieved. When you take rest, it is relieved. So that is the difference between myocardial infarction and angina. Angina is just ischemia. Whereas heart attack is infarction. So there is difference between ischemia and infarction. You know that in you have learnt in pathology. Okay? So angina pectoris is due to ischemia of the myocardium because of the block in the coronary vessels and giving rise to pain in the pectoral area which is radiating to the arms and all. Okay, that is called as angina pectoris, and it is relieved after taking rest because we will be lessening the workload on the heart, and the same blood is enough to nourish that part of the myocardium. If you continue, it continues, so then it goes for infarction. Okay, so you can say these are the preliminary signs of ischemia, the angina. Okay, so which we can prevent the further, what is that, the infarction, the heart attacks. So, angina pectoria means severe chest pain, usually retrosternal, that is behind the sternum and even radiating to the arm due to ischemia of the cardiac muscle. It is ischemia, not infarction. So, myocardial infarction. That means the artery is completely blocked. The artery is completely blocked and there is no blood supply to the distal part. Okay? So, that goes for infarction. The cardiac muscle dies. Okay? So that is continuous pain, even not relieved by rest also. Okay, that is myocardial infarction. Okay. This is the area of what is that? Distribution of pain which are originating from the heart. Okay.
Why specialize the heart
in the left side? Why specialize the left? Because of the segmental innervation. Because of the segmental nerves which are supplying, which are same even distributed to the same arm and arm. Yeah, the segmental innervation, you know the theory behind referred pain and all. The same intercostal nerves which are there here, which are supplying this area, for example, intercostal 2 nerves, they will be supplying the heart also. But that feels like that visceral pain is referred to this area. Yeah. For example, the toothaches are sometimes we consider you will have a headache because the same trigeminal innervation, the trigeminal nerve, three divisions supply different, like ophthalmic, maxillary, and mandibular, right? So that as is supplied by mandibular nerve here, branches from that. So as the other parts like maxillary and ophthalmic, they're also from trigeminal nerve. So same segmental innervation, you will have headaches also from the toothache, like that. The referred pain. So you can see here, one of the important point here, so this is what is called as a bypass graft, you know, how this coronary, you say the open heart surgery they do, he had undergone bypass surgery, we say. What do you mean by bypass surgery? So here, look at this picture carefully, see what is happening here. So this is the one vessel, okay, here it is blocked, okay, and even here also it is blocked. So now this part goes for infarction. This part of the heart goes for infarction. So then what we'll do next? They will do take some graft or venous graft from anywhere, from saphenous vein or somewhere. Okay? They take and see here what they have done. They connected the aorta to the distal part of the block by a different vessel. See this? This is bypassing this vessel. As there is a clot here, the blood is not flowing down, so what happens? Directly from blood from the aorta, it is flowing to the distal part of the block. So that this is again irrigated with the blood. This is called as bypass. Either they done through with the aorta or with the internal thoracic artery, mammary artery or the bronchial arteries, any arteries they choose. Okay? That is called as CABG. Surgery is called as CABG. What is that CABG? Coronary artery bypass graft. So they take a graft. They take a graft, the venous graft, okay, and connect the different artery to the vessel which is blocked, distal to the blocking side. Clear? This procedure is called as CABG. This is called as the bypass surgery, we say. Did you understand that point?
Yes.
So one more procedure is called as angioplasty. What is it called as? Angioplasty. What do you mean by angioplasty? See here. So here is the coronary vessel which is blocked. Okay, by atherosclerotic plug. Okay. So what they do? They take a catheter. Either they pass through the femoral vein or through the radial, any route. Okay. And then pass that catheter through all the arteries, like from the femoral vein they go to your iliac vein, common iliac vein, inferior vena cava, atrium, and then they go to ventricle, then the artery, okay, the aorta, and then go to the coronary vessel. They guide it through the TV monitor, okay, and then go to the block site. They go to the block site, and this is what is that? An instrument like a balloon. So at the block site they grow, and then they manipulate and then dilate the vessel. They will put a stent, you know, the stent, the metal stent coated with some medicals and all. Okay? So that stent will enlarge so that it enlarges the vessel and then the blood flows down. The blood flows down, dilating the blocked area. Okay? And then they remove the catheter, leaving behind the stent there. So that continuously it will be dilating the vessel. So that the blood flow will be continuous. So this procedure is called as angioplasty. What is it called as? Angioplasty. Yeah. So this is the one more procedure called as angioplasty. These are the two procedures which are done in the what is that? It's a myocardial infarctions. Post stabilizing the patient. So that's all about the coronary circulation. Okay? Thank you.